somebody had a birthday. Betty had a birthday. June 1st, 96 years old. And still drives. Still got all the wits about it.
Still baking cakes.
Still baking cakes. And a happy birthday.
Thank you.
We look forward 4 years from now to celebrating your 100th with you. And speaking of celebrating birthdays, I was told this morning that this is a milestone birthday for Bill Moyer. Bill is one of our younger members here, and he turns the big 6-0 today. I'm reminded of being at a birthday party years ago, Bill, when the guest of honor was celebrating her 90th birthday. And a wonderful lady named Hilda, who was 98, came in, and she raised her arms and said, "Oh, Bertha, I'd give anything to be 90 again." Well, most of us here would give anything to be 60 again, right? While we're on such topics, where's Betty Mason? There. You got a birthday. June 20th? Is that right? June 20th, and it didn't get in the newsletter. So June 20th. And it's coming up pretty quick here. June 19th? Is that right? June 12th? June 12th. Is this 70 years? 69. Reno and Carol will be celebrating their 69th wedding anniversary. Don't shoot for 70, shoot for 75. All right? Don't shoot for 70, shoot for 70. Yeah, I'll show your wheelchair around wherever you need to go. Well, I'm counting on coming back for your 100th birthday party, too. Yeah. Joys and celebrations. We celebrate birthdays, we celebrate anniversaries. We are grateful for every year we live. And somewhere I've got a sheet of announcements. Don't forget Meals of Hope. If you've signed up to serve, don't forget. If you haven't signed up to serve, sign up. Remember to wear your name tag. Bookmarks. There are those bookmarks in the pews. They're wonderful things that on one side allow you to make contributions to the Langley Presbyterian Church through the wonders of modern technology with your cell phone. Now, I'm not smart enough to know how to do that. Nani knows, yes. Somebody's already figured it out and done it. So there's somebody here that knows how to do it. Figure it out. If you want to give with your cell phone, and if you do give monthly or annually and want to drop something into plate to indicate your support for the church, that's the purpose of that card. You can drop it into plate and it says, "I gave." And we're grateful to our Finance and Stewardship Committee for bringing us into the 21st century with this technology. Let's see. Bookmarks. Friendlies. Lowbrow Pizza. I saw the sign this week upon the trail on the west side in the old Five Guys location. It says, "Lowbrow Pizza and Beer." Just the kind of place that Friendly's meets. And that will be Thursday? Is that right? This Thursday? At 11:30? Is that right?
Yep.
Thursday at 11:30, Lowbrow never been there before, may never go there again, but we're going to do it once.
The food is very good.
The food is, Bonnie, if Bonnie says it's good, it's good. Okay, the June cook-in will be Saturday, June 16th at noon. And Bill Clipper is already taking money for that, signing folks up out in the narthex. Committee meetings this week. Stewardship and Finance Committee meets Wednesday at 9 and at 10:30. The Membership Committee, don't forget Bill Deep's Bible study at 1 o'clock every Wednesday afternoon during the summer continues. Bill also is in charge of the Good Shepherd Food Pantry. And Bill, that box was full last week. Have they filled it up again this week? Do you know? Bill and I were talking last week. Among the Plains Indian tribes, this month of June was called the Starving Moon. And it was called that because none of the berries or fruits ripe. So this is a hungry time for a lot of people because the kids don't get the free lunches and free breakfast at school. So they become more and more dependent upon programs like Meals of Hope on our parking lot on Monday afternoon and our Good Shepherd Food Pantry, which Bill administers. So if you haven't already gone north, if you're going north, if you're going on vacation, if you're cleaning out the pantry, cleaning out the beans, the rice, the cereal, the canned goods, bring them here. Bill will see that they're put to good use, right? All right, have we got any other announcements to make this morning? Then let us continue to prepare to worship God.
Peace.
mother.
Your lesson this morning is a story from the Old Testament. It's about the story of a little boy named Samuel. Now, I know that Mia does an awful lot to help around the church. I've seen her help set up food, refreshments, for our fellowship after church, right? And I've seen you pass out bulletins on Sunday morning too, haven't I? Yeah. When Samuel was 3 years old, his mother took him to the temple, which was in a place called Shiloh in those days, to the priest named Eli. And she said, "Do you remember me?" And Eli kind of scratched his head and said, "I'm not sure." He said, "Well, I'm the woman that came here 3-4 years ago. And I promised God that if I had a child, I would bring that child and dedicate that child to the Lord, and he would serve the Lord all his days. Here he is." And she left Samuel with Eli, turned around and went on. Samuel was only 3 years old. Now, Samuel stayed there in the temple, the shrine at Shiloh, and served the Lord all the days of his life. Now, or do you think he could serve the Lord every day by going about his business and doing what he was supposed to do and acting like he was supposed to act, honoring God, serving God by serving other people? Could he do that? Yeah. There's an old hymn that goes, "You servants of God, your master proclaim." something nice to them. Maybe by feeding them when they're hungry. Maybe by smiling at them. A smile is a gift from God. And when you share it with someone, you share a gift of God with someone else. You're serving God. You don't have to be dedicated in the temple. Be dedicated to God every day of your life, do you? But Samuel was. We'll talk more about his story later. Okay? Let's pray. Lord, help us every day in every way to proclaim your love to those around us. In Jesus' name we pray. And now let all God's children say,
Amen.
Holy, crying God. and firm in your faith, covered by the saving grace of God, and ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Eternal God, in whom we live and move and have our being, from whom we come and unto whom we shall surely someday return, we thank you for the gift of life, for the precious gift that we are given in these earthen vessels. We thank you for the years that we have lived, whether they be 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100, yet these years are but a prelude, but a preface to life everlasting. We thank you for that hope we have of a life that transcends death, of a hope that transcends death. In this life we suffer, O Lord, aches and pains, illnesses, sorrows, yet you comfort us in all our sorrows. You heal us of all our afflictions. And if there be not healing, then there be patience. Lord, give us patience in all things to await your will. In these troubled and troublesome times, we pray for each one whose needs are great. We pray for those who sorrow, who have lost loved ones in battle, in school shootings, in senseless acts of violence, in traffic accidents. All whose lives have been shortened unnaturally, we pray your blessings upon those who mourn them. In all things, Father, help us to see your will, your purpose, and find your peace. For we pray in the name of the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God. Let us offer our lives to the Lord as we bring God's tithes and our offerings.
Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Eli has told the boy Samuel to respond when the Lord speaks. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And Samuel does. And God speaks. I've never heard the voice of God speak to me. I know that I have felt God's call, and I felt God's guidance and direction and comfort and protection in my life. But a voice, a clear call, a clear command, not once, not ever. Perhaps it's my fault. Perhaps I have not said clearly enough, often enough, maybe not even once. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. Maybe I have heard God's voice and didn't recognize it. Samuel didn't when he first heard it. But God doesn't speak to us in the 21st century as God spoke to the prophets of old. God doesn't single out prophets to speak the word of God to God's chosen. Sometimes I wish God did. Most times I'm glad God doesn't. If God gave me a message to deliver, I'm fearful that it would be a message of judgment, of doom and destruction, like the one that God gave to Samuel. To say that I have not heard the voice of God does not mean that I have not heard the call of God. Obviously, at some point in my life, I felt the call of God to the gospel ministry. Let me talk to you a little bit about how that process of calling can work. A year ago, I was coming to the end of a contract, a two-year contract with the Presbytery of Sierra Blanca in New Mexico. It was a transitional contract, a terminal contract, 24 months and then leave, and I knew that. In March of last year, we were coming to Florida for the RKU rodeo and some doctor's appointments. And I called Graham Hart at the Presbytery office, and I said, Graham, I'm going to be in town in March. If there are any churches that are looking for an interim pastor or a supply, I'd be glad to talk to them while I'm in town. And Graham arranged for me to have an interview with a committee looking for an interim pastor for a church in the northern part of our presbytery. I happen to know two members of the committee from my previous service in this presbytery. I had a wonderful interview with them. Problem was, they wanted somebody to start April 1st. I was committed through the end of June in New Mexico. Couldn't see myself starting until the middle of July, maybe the 1st of August. They wanted somebody right now. And so they went in another direction. And that was fine. In May, Polly and I were flying east for Mother's Day with her mother, and I was able to schedule two interviews, one with a church in West Virginia. Coincidentally, a church that I talked to 35 years earlier about becoming their pastor. And then a church in Middle Tennessee, about an hour's drive. Polly's mother's home. Had good interviews with both of them. Toward the end of May, I was talking to building contractors and realtors about a home on the Cumberland Plateau in Middle Tennessee and talking about going to be the stated supply pastor of a small church. And a phone rang. And it's Graham Hart. Graham says, we have a church here that needs an interim pastor and they need somebody right now. Lady Presbyterian Church. I said, well, I can't start till maybe the 1st of August. He said, that's soon enough. Can you talk to them? Will you talk to them? I said, sure. I haven't signed any papers with the church in Tennessee. I'm not committed. Within a day or two, Tim Howerson, chair of the committee on ministry, called, and she said, Lady, church could use your gifts, your talents, your abilities. I said, okay, I'm willing and able to talk to them. And then an old friend of mine, colleague in ministry, Terry Wimberly, called, and Terry was calling about something totally disengaged from church work, about phosphate mining in DeSoto County, Tennessee. He was writing a book and he needed my input since our little ranch is right next door to where the phosphate mine will be. So he and I talked for about 45 minutes on the phone, and as he was hanging up, he said, by the way, I understand that Bailey Church is looking for an interim pastor. If you want to come back to Florida, that'd be a great place for you. It's a great church, great people. I love it. God doesn't have to hit me in the head with a hammer. its telephones and its computers. And I did a Skype interview with Jim Houck and two, three others. They didn't have to hear me preach. They could see videos of me preaching in other churches and hear tapes and do all this online. My goodness. God can speak through a computer and a cell phone. Yes. Because God can. In the morning, after God had spoken to the old priest Eli, Eli asked the boy Samuel to tell him what the word of the Lord that had come in the night was. And with great courage, Samuel told Eli that the judgment of the Lord was upon his household, upon his sons. The high point of the story to me, the punchline, is the old priest's response. There is no anger, no denial, no arguing with God's judgment or Samuel's delivery of the message. Eli merely says, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to them." It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good, right, fitting to him. Even if it means my sons will die, even if it means that my lineage will vanish from the earth, let the Lord do what seems good to him. That is faith. That is commitment. That is servanthood. That is loyalty. That is honoring God's call. Let us pray. Speak, Lord. Your servants are listening. And God, if you speak, may we accept your word as willing as Eli and say, "It is the Lord." Let the Lord do what seems good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us stand and affirm what we believe with the mystery of our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered. joyful feast of the people of God. They will come from east and west and from north and south and sit at the table of the kingdom of God. Jesus invites to this table everyone who wants to experience God's love, receive God's grace and power, and join hearts with Jesus' followers here and around the world. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes." Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you for the gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine. We thank you for those who grew them, for those who prepared these elements for this service this morning. Set apart this bread and this wine from common uses. This uncommon use in the sacrament that reminds us of the death upon the cross of Jesus Christ, where his body was broken and his blood was shed, that we might be forgiven, washed of our sins, renewed in life. Thank you that Christians the world around join together. May we come with clean hands and pure hearts as they do to this table, to be renewed, to be refreshed, to be refilled. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The things of God for the people of God. Come now. Thank you. join me in the prayer I would give them. We give you thanks, Lord Jesus Christ, for the gift of grace we have received from your hand. Now send us forth to reflect your life, proclaiming your second death and resurrection, until you come again in glory. Amen. Our closing hymn is found on page 11, Jesus Saves. Now.